So, fun! Elder desserts first, then lunch?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
So just to tag on to what Barb said, yes, it was delightful to be greeted the way we were in this church and the way we have been ever since. And Scott, how on earth you're going to be able to get people from our home state or the home state of new visitors aligned every week is beyond me, but I'm sure you'll figure out a way to make it happen. If I could draw your attention to page 16 of the bulletin this morning, I just want to give a on this. Voters Assembly and Members Information Meeting will be held on Sunday, June 18th at 9:45 a.m. in the Fellowship Hall. A briefing on the status of the Narthex audio visual AV upgrade will be made. Voters will be asked to approve the expenditure of an additional $12,000 of designated and reserve funds to complete the video upgrade. And information will also be provided on the use of our new online presence, goodshepherd.info. Pastor Sparling will be out of town, therefore the remaining Bible class time will be utilized for general fellowship. Thank you.
We have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
though we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God, our Father. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We are sinned against you, God, word and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name.
Amen. Almighty God, for his mercy has given his Son, who died for you and for his sake, forgives you all of your sins. Therefore, I, as a called and ordained servant of the word of Christ, and by his authority, forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and their praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Keep us steadfast in this faith and always defend us.
God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We read Psalm 8 responsively by verse. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens.
Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you,
faith using the words of the Athanasian Creed, we have instead offered the three apostles' creed, shall we? I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and he sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated. I
apologize for the irreverence of my humor there a moment ago, but it does occur to me that if we had put the Athanasian Creed in, our bulletin would have been about 4 pages longer. And do you know the Athanasian Creed? Okay, some of you maybe it looks like you're not real sure. There are three creeds that the church uses to confess its faith. They are known as the three ecumenical creeds because they are regarded as the most basic confessions of Christianity. And the Athanasian Creed is it arose in particular because the doctrine of the Trinity was being challenged by some very prominent thinkers at the time, and so the church gathered and created a third statement of its faith, particularly focusing on the doctrine of the Holy Trinity, which, of course, brings us to today. This is Trinity Sunday, and that is the Sunday of the church year when pastors all over the world endeavor to confuse their parishioners with explanations of the Holy Trinity. That I will, to some extent, probably do as well. I'm game for that. The doctrine of the Holy Trinity is definitely one of those things that the more you think about it, the more it's sort of like system overload in the brain. It's not a thing that is going to end up making sense at the end of the day. And it's strange, too, because, and I remember this when I was younger, I guess this was, maybe it's because it was a more popular thing to say 30 years ago, I don't know, or maybe it was just because my peers were of an age where this was a clever thing to say, but the word Trinity is never used in the Bible. Well, that's true enough. I was thinking, how can I explain this? And I thought, well, okay. Most science books that you read that talk about geology and the like, they don't go into great detail about the spherical nature of Earth. They don't go into long treatises about the shape of the circle, of the sphere, and how a sphere is not exactly a square, a cube, and it's a, you know, so you don't have whole entire books written about the spherical nature of Earth. Because it's understood. It's an idea that's underneath every other endeavor of that kind. It's understood. I think that's a one way to understand why in the Bible you don't have like extended dialogues or paragraphs that explain in great detail about the doctrine of the Holy Trinity. It's simply something that sits underneath as an understanding, an underlying idea that faithful children of God have always known. By the way, that's Peter's point when at the end of the Acts reading, he quotes David from the Psalms saying, "The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand." Now, right there you have, believe it or not, one of the great texts that helps us to understand the doctrine of the Trinity. Why? Well, so, David is a king. David is a king. A king is, well, another word for king in the Old Testament would have been the Yes, my Lord. Yes, my Lord. Yes, my Lord. Okay, so David, as the king, there's nobody above the king. Now, in this psalm, Peter is saying, why then does David say, the Lord said to my Lord? Now, if you're reading that in the Old Testament text, you'll see it says the Lord in all capital letters. So this is Yahweh. So God said to my Lord. Well, who's David's Lord? So it's someone slightly different than the Lord. Because Yahweh said to my Lord. So there's at least two persons involved in this conversation. There's the Lord, Yahweh, and then there's David's Lord. Now, the second time Lord appears in the Hebrew text, it's not Yahweh. It's not all capital letters. So that's the word for king. So who's David's king that Yahweh is speaking to? Well, the light of the New Testament casts a little information on that. David's talking about the Messiah, about Jesus, actually. And what does he say about Jesus? Well, Yahweh said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. So now you've got Yahweh, and you've got someone sitting at Yahweh's right hand who's greater than David. So now, the idea of Jesus being of equal quality with the Father is underneath that text. But David doesn't put a little, you know, asterisk with a footnote at the end of the psalm saying, well, in this psalm, I'm relying heavily on the doctrine of the Trinity. He doesn't do that because it's just understood. Another text that was included in our readings today, and this is another fascinating one. This is probably something you don't know, but the Genesis reading, where it says, the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the deep. You read that? Well, the Jews for centuries read those texts in common everyday use. They didn't read them in Hebrew, actually. They read them in Aramaic. Aramaic was the Greek. They maintained the Hebrew texts. But for functional everyday use, they used what were called the targums. You ever heard that word, the targums? As someone who's studied Bible, may have heard that word. The targums were the Aramaic translations of the Hebrew text. And so they were the everyday kind of scripture that you might use. And just like Letterton over there, he's got a King James Bible on his shelf, but he uses the Message every day. For his everyday text. It's in a language that he, Jim, you're more comfortable with the language of the Message than let's say, the King James Version, right? So this is what they use, the Targums. And in the Targums, where it says that the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the deep, the Aramaic there says, the Spirit of God was fluttering over the face of the deep like a dove. Well, okay, that was very good until in Mark chapter 1, Jesus is being baptized, and the Holy Spirit descends from heaven. How? Like a dove. And all of the first century Jews should have been going, oh, I get it. I get it. The doctrine of the Holy Trinity. Right, so this is the kind of thing. It's like, there are a couple of texts, I think, that invite us a little deeper. Colossians, I think it's Colossians 2:9, where it says that the fullness of the deity dwelt in Jesus in bodily form. The fullness of God, the fullness of the Godhead, dwelt in Jesus. Now, what in the world could that possibly mean? Well, it means that Jesus is God, but it doesn't mean that Jesus is part of God and that the Father is enough, like God is a pie And there are three slices of the pie. And you've got the Holy Spirit slice, and you've got the Father slice, and you've got the Son slice. No, Colossians 2:9 blows that out of the water. The entirety of God is in Jesus Christ. He's fully God. There's no God without him, and there's no him without God. If I look carefully, I'm going to start seeing wrinkled brows, because this is where the circuits start to get crossed. It's just not easy to fathom a God who's three persons but one God, and he's no more three than one and no more one than three. Don't get it. I confess it, and I believe it, and it's underneath everything I think and do. Just don't ask me to explain it. I can't. The doctrine of the Holy Trinity, of course, is, well, you can find it, I invite you to find it in all three of those texts, and then expand your search to the rest of the Scripture, and you'll see it at work all over the place. But the text that in particular draws us into focus today is the Gospel reading from Matthew 28. Maybe you saw that Matthew 28 reading and you thought, oh, Pastor Sparkling's going to keep talking to us about mission. That's a mission text. That's the reading, that's the text where it's the ascension moment of Jesus, and so he's kind of giving his disciples sort of his last instructions, maybe. And he says, let me lift the underneath the curtain here of that text too. It's a Greek text. And you might think when you're reading in English that the imperative command in that text is to go. Because it says, go, make disciples. But in actuality, that's just a participle. It's going. So as you're out and about, and the imperative command in the text is to make disciples. So as you're, doing what you're doing, as you're working, as you're visiting, as you're in your leisure time, whatever it is that you're doing, and when you find yourself doing, there's never not a time to make disciples. And how do you make disciples? Well, you teach them everything that Jesus has commanded, and you baptize them into one name. It doesn't say baptize them into the names of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, does it? See, there's the doctrine underneath the text. And Jesus doesn't pause and say, well, let me explain this in greater detail to you. Why there's one name but three, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. No, it's the name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I don't get it. But that's the name into which we're baptized. Now, a name in the Bible is more than what we, you and me, today, you and I think of as a name. We largely, in our culture, largely just regard a name as a label. I'm Dan. Nice to meet you. Oh, you're Jerry, or whatever your name is. So, that's the way we think of names. But clearly, in the Bible, names mean more than just a label. They are a reference to your nature and your being. So that's why so often in Scripture, when God does something incredible with a person, he changes their name. Because he's transforming their identity. He's transforming their nature and their being. He's saving them, giving them a purpose. And so a name, in biblical literature, a name is more than just the word that you use to refer to someone. It's a reference to a person's nature and being. And therefore, it is in the nature of God, it is in his being, that he is Father, Son, Holy Spirit. It's part of his nature to be three and yet one name. Okay, so you see it, there it is. And so what does it mean then how are we going to understand that the way to make disciples is to baptize them into this it must be that it's very practical to have a triune faith, a faith in the triune God. Okay? Well, it certainly protects us from certain things. So, let's look for just a moment at some of the other kind of options, other views about God that aren't triune views. So, for instance, there has been throughout history a propensity to believe in one God, but not one God and three persons. Maybe then, if you believe in one God, but you're not sure how to divide that, and of course you don't divide, but into three persons. Well, maybe then you say, okay, so the God, the Father, whatever you want to refer to him, that he's God, and then the Son and the Spirit are sort of lesser expressions of divinity somehow. And that's a heresy known as subordinationism. And we're not subordinationists, we're Trinitarian. And so we believe that Jesus is equal with the Father and the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is equal with the Father and Jesus. And yet they're not three, they're one. So another example, well, of course, everyone's familiar with polytheism. And polytheism simply means there's more than one God. Well, it sounds like we're being polytheistic until we strictly adhere to the teaching that no, there are not three gods. This was the big deal for the Athanasian Creed. There aren't three gods, there is one God. Yes, it is in three persons. Jesus is God, and the Holy Spirit is God, and the Father is God. Not three, one God. Three persons. So a Trinitarian faith protects you against polytheism, protects you against subordinationism. It protects you against Unitarianism. Now, Unitarianism, see, you thought understanding the prayer that I prayed up there was going to be difficult. Wait till you get to the sermon. Unitarianism is a belief whereby you just have one God, and he's just expressing himself in three different ways, but you don't have three distinct persons. It's just one person who's being observed in three different ways. That's Unitarianism, and it's also false teaching. Most of the what we normally think of as the polytheists of the Old Testament weren't really so much polytheists, but they were a unique brand of polytheists. They were henotheists. Now, a henotheist is someone who believes that every country has its own God. That's a variety of polytheism, but it's a unique variety. So, the Canaanites had Canaanite gods, and the Phoenicians had Phoenician gods, and, well, the Israelites have their God, too. Also, false. God is the God of Isaiah. He says Isaiah 43. It's like, I am God over all the ends of the earth, over all peoples and languages and people groups. So you've got that. There's more. There are more kind of different heresies that I can share with you. But let's just cut that part of the thing. Sure. Suffice to say that a proper understanding of the Trinitarian faith protects you from having a faulty understanding of who God is in his nature and in his being. More practically, though, and this will be, I think, the most easy to understand point. And for sort of like that's the end of the doctrine part of the sermon. Now let's get to the practical. The fact that God is three persons in one divine being. When you think about it, and this is probably why the Biblicists chose the Genesis reading and what have you. It means, folks, that love is more important than success. Let me explain that. The Bible teaches
very clearly. And the Genesis reading shows it. Other scriptures teach as well. John chapter 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word is God made flesh. That's verse 14. And so we understand the Word as being Jesus. And we see then in that Genesis reading, we see the Father, we see the Son, and the Word, and we see the Spirit fluttering over the face of the deep. There they are prior to the creation of the world. Prior to the creation of the world. Now, if there weren't a Trinity, if God were just, if we were unitheists, just belief in a singular one God, unipersonal God, not in three persons, it would make some sense that he would want to create the entire world, because he'd be awfully lonely, wouldn't he? Putting a little bit of human ideology into our understanding of God. I don't know if he would be lonely or not, but it would make some sense that a God who's by himself, alone in the whatever the universe is, which doesn't exist yet, would need to make something, or would at least want, desire to make something, so that he would have something to share himself with. He could make something by which he could be worshipped and all the rest. But that's not the situation at all in prior to creation. God is actually a community prior to creation. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Each one giving glory and sharing love with the other. It's this perfect union of love and respect and glory and honor and praise and all the things that we saw in the This Is the Feast hymn, which, by the way, those of you who come to Wednesday afternoon Bible class, did you recognize the Revelation reading in the This Is the Feast song that we sang? Yeah, isn't that cool?
It's the seven spirits.
It's the seven spirits, right? Right, we just studied that text this past Wednesday. So, kind of cool, isn't it? Yeah, I was thinking that as we were singing it. Well, that was a revelation. So, but there you have it also in Revelation. I mean, it's just another text that kind of undergirds what we believe about the Trinity. But here's the point. See, before the creation of the world, God was Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So he already had love. In fact, in a perfect way, this perfect relationship, this love that's shared by the three and given. And in fact, that's really why I think what's so amazing to me is that none of the three persons of God demands glory or demands love. It's in their nature and their essence not to demand it, just to give it. They just give glory to one another. They give honor to one another. They give praise to one another. They give love to one another. And so, what's the purpose of creating the world except that to create a world that would be modeled after them? A world which would love, not demand to be loved, a world that would give love, a world that would give glory, a world that would give praise and honor and might and all the things that we hear going on in Revelation. And so, when the world was begun, when God made everything, it says that he made us, particularly, he made us what? In his image. See, he has created us to imitate, to be givers of love. And so you might think, and I know we probably particularly live in a culture that places success above love. And there may be seasons in our lives where we need to particularly buckle down and work hard. And that may at times, it probably does at times, cause us to perhaps even neglect the ones we love. That happens. the rest of us. But in reality, the higher purpose isn't for me to get to work and get things done. The highest purpose of my life is to love. Is to love y'all, especially to love my wife and my children and my friends, my family. What could be a higher calling than that? That's how the doctrine of the Trinity informs me as to how to live. It's a very practical lesson that comes out of a very complicated and rather impossible teaching. As a church, as a congregation, we're a congregation, we are a community that is formed in the image of the Trinity. And so we're not gathered here as a congregation to make Good Shepherd great, to make the building great, the property great, though we do a really wonderful job of that kind of thing and other stuff too. I mean, we want to be good stewards of this. But before we're a building, before we're a property, before we're a budget, before we're a committee, before we're a board, before we're a list of activities, before we're a website, before we're anything, we're a community of love. That's what it means to have a Trinitarian faith. It doesn't mean to be able to compare the doctrine of the Trinity to a four-leaf, three-leaf clover, or whatever, I don't know, all these, you guys have probably heard all the metaphors. I don't use the metaphors because none of them are good. The famous one, well, to me it's famous because it was the one that I liked for a long time, and so it helps a little bit, but it falls down. I'll show you how it falls down, and you throw out your own metaphors that you've enjoyed over the years. Someone uses the apple one, and there's a banana one. But the H2O one was always my favorite. Whereas you could say that H2O, it can be in the form of a gas, when it's steam. It can be in the form of a solid, when it's an ice cube, and it can be in the form of a liquid. All three of those forms are H2O. The problem is it can't be all three at once. So it just falls apart. Every single one of them will fall apart. So that little metaphor of the H2O, oh, that's very clever. I'm going to use that. Don't use that. It's modalism. Another one of the heresies. So don't go there. Just confess it as the Bible teaches it, that it's underneath everything we do and believe. But what my point is this. If we are a community of faith that is formed around this idea that God himself is three persons, but one God, and these three persons exist in a beautiful symphony of love, then what are we to do but join the dance? And what that means is you look around this room, and these are the people God has called you to love. These people. These are the ones. Now, not all of you, but most of you have been around here longer than I have. So, you might know a thing or two about some of the folks sitting in this room. You might think, well, that person's still coming here. Shouldn't that person? I hope that person has repented. Well, we know all about their sins. So you probably know enough about some of the people in this room that your heart hesitates a little bit to give yourself to them. I'm telling you, a Trinitarian Christian gives himself or herself particularly to the people that God has gathered them to be with. This is our Christian family. Now, we are also united with Christians all over the world. Sometimes, some Sundays, I'll talk like that. And I'll talk about the global nature of Christianity. But today, I want to just talk about the local nature of it, because I think that's that's what the Trinity is calling us into. This divine symphony of love where the Father is just, they're not demanding love, they're giving love. They're not demanding glory, they're giving glory. So look around and identify the person or persons in this room that you have least loved. Make a goal for yourself to give. Give of yourself to that person. Get to know them. I had a conversation just this morning with someone who said, well, yeah, I mean, at first I got to know this person, and at first I thought, boy, that's going to be a hard person to hang out with. And now I realize what a beautiful person that is. And I like to spend a lot of time with that person. You understand? That's Trinitarian faith. Can you do that? If not, let me tell you what your way in. There's a way into the Trinity. And it's the same for all of us. In Jesus Christ, God has made himself more known to you than any other way. Jesus is your most obvious pathway into understanding God. He comes right out and says it, doesn't he? There's no way to the Father except through me. Well, he's made that perfectly clear. So what is it that we're supposed to, how is it that understanding and meditating on and learning about and increasing in faith in Jesus, how does that welcome us into this Trinitarian faith? Well, what we see first and foremost is that God so loved you and me. God so loved us that he himself, no other religion in the world has ever been like this, that God himself took all of your shortcomings. We call it sin in this building. God himself took that. He identified himself as the sinner. A strange exchange took place. He didn't just say, well, you know, I'll take care of that for you. He took it off of you and put it on himself. He became sin, who knew no sin, so that we might become the righteousness of God. That's the exchange. So, here's your way into understanding the Trinity. See, I told you, God is a giver. He gives love. He doesn't demand it. He gives glory. He doesn't demand it. He gives mercy. He doesn't demand it. That's what he's done to you. That's how God himself, and look, if Jesus isn't God, you've got some doctrinal work to do. Go back to your creed. I believe in God, Father Almighty, Jesus Christ, the Son, our Lord, Holy Spirit. That's the creed. I believe in God. Well, who's God? Father, Son, Holy Spirit. All three creeds form the same way. There's a reason for that. So if you're not sure about Jesus as God, well, we go back to square one. But if you got that down, which I think most of you do, then look at him and see what he's done for you. And understand that he has done it for you so that you could be part of that symphony of love. So that you could begin to do that same kind of thing for each other. You can become a giver, not a demander. And that's my prayer for you today. I pray that you would pray that same prayer for me, and that together we might walk, and that therefore together we might be a community that's making disciples by, well, it's of course baptizing, but let's just say by incorporating people into the faith in the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. that she would be kept until he welcomes her home as his spotless bride. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That the light of Jesus would shine through us so that others may see our good works and give glory to our Father, who with the Son and the Spirit created all things. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the protection of our youth from sin and temptation, for broken families, that they would confess their sins and forgive each other as Christ has forgiven them. For those who celebrate marriage anniversaries, that their love may never grow weary. And for our elderly, as they cope with physical limitations, that they may cling to God's mercies, which are new every morning. Let us pray to the Lord. For the preservation of government and law, to protect the weak and to foster godly virtue, for our president, for our governor, and for all who make and administer and judge our laws, for the armed forces, for emergency medical workers, and for those who teach in our schools, that those who would seek to oppress us by twisting the truth would be frustrated. Let us pray to the Lord. For all who are sick and lonely, whose hearts are heavy with grief, or who are in any need, that they would be healed and given relief by the Lord, who upholds his creation and his will. Let us pray to the Lord. Hear us, Heavenly Father, for the sake of Christ Jesus, our Lord, who has taught us also to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.